Yes, you can start.
Hello everyone, this is Dr. Rupali Patil Jain. I'm an ENT surgeon as well as a medico-legal consultant. Today I'm going to talk on medico-legal aspects in mucormycosis, what an ENT surgeon must know. This webinar has been organized so that we are ready to face the third pandemic or the third epidemic, that is the legal cases against the ENT surgeons regarding mucormycosis. Now, what all aspects an ENT surgeon might face once they have seen a patient of mucormycosis or they have operated a patient of mucormycosis? First is not taking a proper informed consent. There can be poor documentation, misdiagnosis, time gap between the MRI and the surgery, the incomplete removal of the disease, unable to give the medical treatment because of the unavailability of amphotericin B, recurrence of the disease, poor communication with the patient, the death of the patient, and the legal, and once you get a legal notice from the patient. So first I will start with the informed consent. This is the most important point whenever you take a patient of mucormycosis, how an informed consent should be. The Supreme Court has given some guidelines. This is a case, a landmark judgment of Prabha Manchanda. In this, the Supreme Court has given certain guidelines regarding the informed consent. These 6 points should be mentioned in all consent forms. These consent forms, they should be procedure specific consent forms, and all these 6 points should be all be in the same consent form. Usually the doctors, they take a single consent form and they for all the surgeries, but Supreme Court says that the procedure is different, the purpose of the treatment is different, the alternative treatment is different, even the risks are different. So there should be a procedure specific consent form. So the first point is, what is the purpose of the treatment? Why are you operating on the patient? What is the diagnosis? Whether he is suffering from a sinonasal mucormycosis, a palatal, orbital, or a cerebral mucormycosis. So whatever the diagnosis is, it should be mentioned in the consent form. Then comes the nature of the procedure. What type of procedure you are going to conduct? You are going to do an endoscopic procedure. What all you are going to debride? What organs you are going to remove? Are you going to remove the orbit? Are you going to enter the brain? Everything, it has to be mentioned in the consent form. Then third is the benefits or the effects of the procedure. How is the patient going to get benefited by this procedure? Or whether there can be any effects of the procedure, whether he is going to lose his vision, or if there can be some neurological deficits also after the procedure. So the patient should know what all benefits and effects of will be there of the procedure, and how his prognosis is going to be, whether it is going to be good prognosis, a fair prognosis, or a poor prognosis. Fourth most important point, which many of us ENT surgeons, we always miss in our consent forms, that is the alternative treatment. The alternative treatment has to be told to each and every patient. As we know that mucormycosis is a medical disease, but still the surgical treatment is definitely necessary to reduce the fungal load. So in this procedure, there won't be any alternative treatment. Then fifth most important point is the substantial risk. What are the risks of this procedure? Now, the Supreme Court has said that if the risks are less than 2%, then there is no need to mention it in the consent form. But if it is more than 2%, all the risks, they have to be mentioned. So you have to weigh what exactly all risks you have to mention in the consent form. The risks of not doing the procedure. If the patient is not agreeing for the procedure, if the patient does not undergo the procedure, what all risks he might face? So all these risks, they have to be mentioned in the consent form. Similarly, unavailability of the amphotericin, it should be also be mentioned, and chances of recurrence of the disease, because there are high chances that also should be mentioned in the consent form. Then there should be a separate form, consent form. Once you have admitted a patient for surgery, there should be a separate consent form for hospital administration, admission. There should be a separate consent form for anesthesia, which we usually do not take. And the anesthetist, he should sign the consent form along with the patient's signature and the two witnesses. If there is a blood transfusion, a separate consent form should be there for a blood transfusion. Regarding the unavailability of amphotericin B, it should be mentioned also in the hospital admission consent form. and all the operating surgeons should sign the consent form. If there are more than one surgeon, then all the surgeons who are operating, for example, if we are operating with an oculoplastic surgeon or a neurosurgeon, they also should sign the consent form along with the patient as well as the patient's two witnesses. Now, the most important part is the documentation, right? When the patient, he comes into your OPD, he might have the OPD papers, his findings, his complaints. He might have already visited some another ENT surgeon or another doctor. He might have been already been operated prior to, before coming to your place. So all his reports regarding his findings, what all surgery he has undergone, what all organs have been removed, what were his MRI reports that time and now what they are at this time, everything you have to document. Then once you have taken the patient, the hospital admission notes, the surgical notes, the anesthesia notes, and even the discharge card. Because in court, only the documents speak. If the documentation is poor, your defense is going to be very poor and there are high chances of you losing the case. Now, the time gap between the MRI and the surgery. Now, how much should the time be? Time be between the MRI and the surgery. Definitely the patient, when he comes, you cannot wait for the biopsy report. So, and when the patient comes with the MRI report, try to do it as soon as possible because this is a fast growing disease. And if you're, if the time gap is more, you should have a valid defense ready with you that why did you take so much time to operate after taking the MRI. If you're unable to give medical treatment because of unavailability of amphotericin, it should also be mentioned in the patient should be told. And but now recently there is a judgment in which the doctors, it has been in the doctor's favor and the court has said that unavailability of medical treatment, the doctors will not be responsible. Misdiagnosis. Definitely when the patient is coming to you for there and you're operating him or her, it could either you have operated either on an allergic fungal sinusitis or even a bacterial sinusitis, because the biopsy report, it takes 4 to 5 days and definitely we are not going to wait for for the biopsy report. And we are taking the patient. But once if the diagnosis comes something else and you have done a radical surgery, the patient might go against you in the court. Now, if after doing everything, the patient still has died, then definitely you can get a criminal case can be filed against you. The patient might go to the patient's relatives might go to the police station and you might get a criminal case filed against you. The investigating officer, he will come to your hospital. He will collect all the documents regarding the patient. And these documents, he will submit it to the medical board of nearby medical college. First, they will prefer a government medical college and then a private medical college. The reports will go to the government medical college. A medical board will be formed of the doctors of the same profession. And then if these doctors, this medical board, it gives says that the doctor has been negligent, then a case will be filed against you. But if the medical board says that the doctor is not negligent, then the case will be dismissed. Whatever the decision of the medical board is there, we can definitely challenge the decision. Now, once the case it goes to the medical board, there can be differences of opinion in between two or three ENT surgeons. So definitely this can be a negative point for us. Now, the last and the most important point is what if you get a legal notice from the court? If you get a legal notice, please don't avoid it. Please take it into consideration. You have to send them a reply within 30 days. Take the help of a medico-legal consultant. Or if you're appointing a lawyer, you should appoint a lawyer who has full knowledge of the medical field also. And when he prepares the written statement, please sit with him, tell him all the points, whatever has happened, what all you have done in court, because you're experience, your infrastructure, everything is going to count in your defense. So don't ignore the notice. Please give a reply within 30 days. Thank you. Definitely, we can take questions after this. There is a lot of, I know there are going to be a lot of questions in your mind, so we can discuss these. Thank you, Shri Harsha.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Let us. You can take the questions.
Yeah, I will tell you before the taking the questions. Number one, you said covered the very salient points. First few questions mm-hmm. from my side, because I'm sure those queries may be with everybody. So, okay. Number one is the consent form language. Is it what language it should be in? Bilingual,
sir.
The local language, yeah.
Sir, this the Supreme in the judgment in which the Supreme Court has given the judgment where the about the consent, nowhere it is mentioned that consent should be only in a particular language. But for our safety, I feel that it should be in a language which the patient understands. But still, if you feel that you have a consent which has been written in English, sometimes there are places where 2-3 languages are spoken, because in my area we are on the border of Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra, 2 languages are spoken here, Marathi as well as Hindi. So, and again English, there are some patients who talk even in English. So we can't keep every consent form of every procedure in all three languages. So at least if you are taking a consent form in English, add 2 or 3 lines, ask the patient to write in his own handwriting, and that whatever has been written above, I have fully understood. Or there might be someone with that patient who might understand English, take his or her signature as an interpreter. So I feel that, because yeah. See, we sign, sir, these LIC bonds or these things, all are written in English. We just go on signing, we don't even read them.
I will like to share a small experience about this language business. When I was in Saudi Arabia, there was every paper written in Arabic. And I have to certify that this statement which I have made is correct. Now what to do? Because the person who has translated, I come to know, he can change the content of that. It was mainly for compensation hearing loss. So I used to write as I was told that the English version has been translated in totality, and so I consent that is there. Similarly, we can ask the patient to write in their own language that mujhe is bimari ke bare mein, ya whatever I say in Hindi, I have been told details and the prognosis of this disease, knowing the risk of anesthesia surgery, what happens, I am ready for that. Is that sufficient in the court of law?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So usually what, in such cases, sir, if you're taking consent, so take the patient's relatives or person is with that patient as an interpreter, take that person's signature on it as an interpreter. Usually, and the two witnesses should be different.
Yeah, Rupali, in hospital, we used to have at least 2 signature on that consent form, especially going for any procedure. Then
yes, sir, there should be 4 signatures: the surgeon, the patient, and 2 witnesses.
Okay, fine. Then the second is, sometimes patient may not be able to sign, he is too sick, so his next of kin can give this.
Yes sir, you can take if the patient is unconscious, according to the consent, when the patient is not in the condition to give a consent form, there is no need for him to sign. You can't take a consent of an unconscious patient or a drowsy patient or any patient who is under the influence of alcohol. Mm-hmm. You have to take the patient's relative signature.
Achha, just one more point, as Dr. Bachi also raised this question, you also mentioned about the inavailability of the amphotericin B and other things. I remember when I was a MS student in medical college, there used to be written in Hindi that upkaranon wa dawaon ki kami ko madde nazar rakhte hue, that means knowing the limitations of availability of the medicine and equipment. And we used to laugh, why don't you write in a small letter skill also? We give our consent to get it operated. So will that be sufficient, that the patient was told about the availability of the amphotericin, availability
yes, sir,
of the
yes, sir.
MRI,
yes,
availability
sir.
Of the expertise?
Yes, sir. It only you can take it in the consent form. It's sufficient. And unavailability of amputation, it is a national issue. So I think the court will also consider about that.
As Dr. Bachi asked, probably we don't have to mention separately that the availability of the requisite drugs, we can say. Okay. Then okay. There is one more question. We know the mortality established is around 30-40%. Should death risk be mentioned in every consent?
Yes, sir. In my consent form, which I have prepared, I have mentioned about the death.
Okay. And as you said very correctly about the side effect, one very important question. This is a multi-speciality. You have done an excellent surgery, but patient sugar has gone 500 odd above. So that glycemic control, probably it is not done directly by you, but you being the leader of the team is overall responsible. So who should be the leader of the team? Whether it is a physician, otolaryngologist, neurosurgeon, ophthalmologist, because if you say your eyes will, he will say, when I came in, my eyes were good. I was looking everything. Now my vision has gone. So in the blank consent form, we have mentioned this. Do we have to take services of all these specialists or you are sufficient?
No. See, we all know that mucormycosis is a medical disease, and we have to include everyone in that. If the patient, you have to include the physician, the nephrologist, because of even the neurosurgeon, the ophthalmologist, and not a single person will be responsible. If anything happens to the patient, it is vicarious liability of every surgeon who is involved in that patient.
No, but most of the places, it is being operated by ENT surgeons. So naturally, ENT surgeon is there, anesthetist is there, and ophthalmologist are there. Because of the rhino, orbital, and ophthalmic, you get the services of the neurosurgeon. Is it in any way detrimental? Or maxillofacial role comes
first? Sir, I couldn't understand your question.
See, basically, most of the places, it is the otolaryngologist, anesthetist, and the Clearly, are you getting me?
Sir, there are a lot of background noises. Okay, huh. So there are multiple surgeons involved. So, what is your next question?
I say it is only ENT and ophthalmic surgeon. Services of neurosurgeon and physiotherapist, because it cannot come or it will come at a much later. So is that okay?
Shri Harsha, can you just tell me that question? I'm unable to hear sir's voice. Hello, Shri Harsha. Can you repeat that question for me? Hello? Shri Harsha, are you there?
No, I think
someone repeat that question. I'm not able to get sir. I'm not able to get the question.
I am Dr. Durga Prasad from Hyderabad. If I am audible, I'll try to.
Yes, sir. You're audible. Yes, sir.
Yeah. The question that I think sir is trying to make is that the point that he's trying to make out is that because it is multimodality treatment, like ENT surgeon is involved, neurosurgeon is involved, then ophthalmologist is involved, anesthesiologist is involved. But in spite of all that, the primary surgical treatment or debridement is by ENT surgeon. So is he going to be responsible or all the other people are going to be responsible for this?
If he has included them in the surgery, then all three will be responsible. But only if he is doing everything, then solely he will be responsible. But
yeah,
if the option is also there, then all three will be equally responsible.
Dr. Prakash, can I add something here?
Yeah, please.
Rajwan.
Hello?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. The responsibility falls on the primary consultant, okay? If the complications are due to the surgical complications, automatically the ENT surgeon who has operated depends on that. And if the negligence part of the anesthetist, okay? Something went wrong during the anesthesia or post-operative immediately, the anesthetist is accountable for that. Since it's a multimodal specialty approach, Okay, the primary physician or the primary negligence will be the utmost important. Rest of them can be explainable with their involvement in that particular case. I must compliment Dr. Rupali, is a wonderful discussion. But the liability does not per se falls only on a single person, but all of them are accountable for the primary responsibility on the prime surgeon. Okay. If there is a mishap of anesthesia, only anesthesia is responsible, no, nobody else.
No, no. But,
and also,
but in practice, in general, and basically all this concept that comes out of the court and here comes the role of your advance information when they ask.
In a hospital is a vicariously liable. Since it's the new kind of a things have cropped up. We never knew there is a medical legal issues in the mucormycosis. But if there is a negligence and the relative or the patient have a liberty to knock the door of the respective medical councils, Consumer Protection Act 2019, there is a wide scope, okay? And there is a tremendous scope to file a case against any of the doctors. And also, they can knock the door of the justice for the criminal negligence also.
Explained it properly, their grievances can be solved to a great extent, and that too, you take this hand. And all you will find that two guys were it is 50 people start creating ruckus, and there once you call the police, they also try to blame you and take the responsibility. Here comes the role of your written documents. Dr. Rupali, can you hear us?
Yes, sir, your voice breaks sometime. Yes, but I am now able to hear you. Sir, next question.
One very important question before I take another question is civil and criminal. Still here, some of the doctors were arrested because of some negligence. Can you throw some light on that? How to protect yourself from that? Civil and criminal cases.
Okay. Sir, see, to prove a doctor negligent, three points are the medical board, it applies the Bolam test. There is a Bolam test which the medical board applies. And if that doctor it falls in that criteria, then only he is held negligent. The first criteria is that there should be a standard treatment for regarding that disease. There should be a standard treatment which is being followed by everyone of that area. Fine. Suppose a particular ENT surgeons, they are following us a treatment for. For example, if we say now tonsillectomy, we are doing the tonsillectomy. Now that the second point is that the doctor has not followed that particular procedure or that whatever the treatment is to be followed, that standard of care. And third is the doctor has done something which no other ENT surgeon will do. So if he has done, if he falls in these three criteria, then only he is termed as a negligent. So whatever should be done has to be done at that particular time. The doctor does not do that particular thing, then he's termed negligent. See, complications arise in each and every procedure. But if you just leave that complication and just leave that patient to die, then you are termed as negligent. But if you have taken full care to take care of the complication, but still the patient has died, then you are not termed as negligent.
Okay. Now, audience, if they want to ask any question, I think they can unmute themselves, can ask the question. Is that okay, Dr. Sriharsha? They can unmute themselves?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Anybody?
Dr. Rajendran Dinesh, sir, has wants to talk. You can unmute.
Yeah, Dr. Rajendran Dinesh.
Good evening, sir. Now, in the present situation, mucormycosis is managed by a team of doctors.
Yeah.
Suppose the surgical team has done a good job, but the patient succumbs due to medical management. Will the medical negligence be labeled on the team, or how does it go about it?
There will be an investigation. What I told you, that the investigating officer, he will submit all the documents to the medical board. Then the medical board will decide why exactly has that, what was the reason, why did the patient die, whether it was a surgical cause, whether it was a medical cause. Then only the doctor, whoever is involved, will held be negligent. There are some cases in which only one doctor has been held negligent. There are some cases all three doctors, then the liability is the liability is also distributed. Sometimes it is 50-50, sometimes it is 70-30 or 60-40, whatever the court, it depends on the court. The court will decide how much each doctor is liable.
Rupali, Dr. Rupali, I will again with my experience in Saudi Arabia. I was as a consultant, and you have asked to come as your opinion. It may be a case, anything. Okay. Once the investigation team comes, first of all, they scan the case sheet, and whosoever seen the case, they requisition everybody. Like when in a medical case, if I have done one or two consultation, they write it, ENT XYZ has been excused of this inquiry. So he, as he said very correctly, suppose if it is a physician, surgeon and the anesthesiologist are involved, when the two are called, it is called by an expert team. The problem here is those experts used to be from outside the state. So there is absolutely no bias. In India, what we see, the medical board constituted is by the local people. So suppose Dr. Rajendra Dinesh Kumar, if you are operating a case, I am in a medical college, I am envious of you. If I am in the medical team as an expert, I may give a biased opinion. So that's a great, great, great problem. What is your take on this, Dr. Rupali?
Sir, usually in India, the nearby medical college team, either government or first, the preference is given to the government college. If there is no government college, then the private medical college. The team, whoever ENT surgeons are there, they are being put on the medical board and their opinion is taken. Then they decide. If they say that the doctor is negligent, then a charge sheet is filed against the doctor. But if they say that the doctor is not negligent, then the case is dismissed.
Can you ask for it? Of the medical board, that Mr. X in that medical board, who is the ENT surgeon and professor in the medical college, he is envious of me because of my practice. Can you ask change? These are the practical problems.
The change, the opinion of the medical board also can be challenged, sir. We can, the patient can challenge, or the doctor, both they can challenge the opinion of the medical board. Then it will go to a higher center.
Higher centers.
Rupali ma'am, is non-availability of any medication a reason for negligence? Can a patient file a negligence because of non-availability of medication? Like for example, now earlier remdesivir, now amphotericin B. Can a patient file negligence from the hospital and the pharmacy?
Even if they file a case. Then we can tell that, because see, now it has the availability of these drugs is under government control, even remdesivir as well as amphotericin. So naturally the government is also involved. If the government is giving us the drugs, now the patient, they're not getting directly to the pharmacy, they are getting it through the government. So we won't be held negligent.
I think Dr. Rupali, here also comes the role of your records. When did the patient come? When you sent the requisition and how long it takes the drug to come. So those things
will be taken care of. That on your prescription pad, just write that please, injection amphotericin has been advised and give it to the patient and keep a record of that, that the amphotericin has been given to the prescription has been given to the patient's relatives.
But right now, this medicine is to be procured by the concerned hospital, not the patient individual. They made a director of the hospital will write, then the person will go with that, with a check or draft to pay to the civil surgeon office, and then from there he gets. This is the procedure.
Yes, at least, but they won't give it unless and until they have our prescription.
Yes, that is true.
Even the medical director will need our prescription.
Yes. So there should not be any delay in giving prescription from our side. Yes. Anything, anybody else?
Last question, sir. Okay, so Vidya Sagar, sir, please continue. I'll
Dr. Proceed. Vidya Sagar, please. Welcome. Hi, Dr. Vidya Sagar. I lost his voice.
Hi,
Dr. Vidya Sagar.
You are able to hear me? Yes, are you able to hear me?
I can hear you better.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
So yeah, yeah, better, better. Is, probably video off is, yeah, better, yeah. Please.
Yeah, so my question is like, you are in a clinic, and there is my clinic, not in a hospital, and you are already examining a patient with a mucormycosis has come to my reception, and they are saying it's urgent, they need to see the doctor right away. I'm in the middle of seeing another patient actually, and the patient gives a call to the doctor directly, and he's saying I have to jump into the clinic because into your room because this patient needs emergency treatment. And he is the doctors say that we are right now seeing a patient in the middle of a patient and we are attending the patient. We will have to see you only next in line. But the patient screams, shouts outside, and the OPD staff says that this call is being recorded, but the patient screams outside and they take the prescription away and they jump away and goes off. So will this be considered any negligence from the doctor's side because you are already attending a patient and you are not sure whether the patient whom is shouting and waiting outside is really emergent or not. So how does the law work there?
Okay, sir. See, first, the law has said that each and every patient who comes in an emergency, he has to be attended. So now, when the patient is coming in your reception, everyone outside the reception is there. They are checking the SpO2, the blood pressure. If your staff feels that really there is an emergency, sir, you have to leave your OPD patient and you have to see the patient. Because if it's a real emergency and if the patient succumbs in your hospital, then you might be held negligent, sir, in such cases. So it's better you, if you're examining just an OPD patient, but if you are in the middle of a surgery, then definitely you can tell that you are operating another patient, you can't leave that patient and you can turn down that patient. But if you're just seeing an OPD patient, you have to attend to that emergency.
No, sir. I am seeing a mucor patient whom we are doing an endoscopy. So which is equally important or equally we cannot ignore that.
Then in such cases, then you can turn away that patient. You can tell that you are in the middle of something. You can't leave this patient also because that is also important. And you can, sir, in such cases, you have to be very polite with those such people because such people are bound to be everywhere and everywhere they create problems. In every city, there are some people
I think Dr. Vidya Sagar, you have to be a bit tactful in those cases because see, they feel emergency, your staff knows it is not an emergency. So you have to be tackled them with a little trick that you try to console, yes, doctor is busy, he will see you out of turn, but have your turn, wait for some time. The moment he comes out, I will make sure that he sees you. So something like that. Because sir, otherwise,
the communication is very important in this. Good communication.
Yeah. It is basically.
The question is, are we supposed to document all our OPD records also? Because I was told that we don't have to document our OPD records. But if it is
sir, we have to document.
We definitely have to. Is it true?
No, sir. Yes, no, we have to document even our OPD records also. OPD, IPD, we have to record. Surgery notes, anesthesia notes, everything has to be recorded. And we have to keep all those records for at least 3 years.
There was a forward today by Dr. Kumaresh, probably. Indoor record for 3 years, OPD, no obligation. You are talking of that, yes. Dr. Vidya?
According to government, sir. It is 3 years, but I advise at least 5 years, because you never know. Because in criminal cases, there is no time limit. Yes. The patient can go anytime to the criminal court. So in civil, it is usually 3 years. So that's why it is 3 years. We have to keep the records.
So even the OPD records, ma'am?
Yes. You have to keep, sir.
Wow. But OPD, 9 out of 10. People write the prescription, give it to the patient. They don't keep a duplicate with most of the clinic in India, at least. So how do you make Dr. Rupali? At
sir,
least my
see,
hospital, we used to have a medical book. Here in my practice right now, we give a prescription and that goes with the patient. I am not keeping anything. Once he complains of anything, I ask him to come with all the records. And probably that is when the liability lies on the patient for OPD patient. What is the rule? I do not know.
We have to keep a copy of OPD records, because tomorrow if the patient goes in court, the court is going to ask us for documents. So we have so many cases of trauma, especially ear slapping.
MLC case is different. Medical legal cases to keep a record. I am talking of general OPD. I am seeing 100 patients a day. I never keep a duplicate of what prescriptions I have issued. And most of the time, if the same patient comes, I can write on the reverse and send them back. So how to, let's say, I think Vidya, most of
sir,
people...
Recently,
sir,
so
you can
best,
use a common
the
paper.
The best answer for this is use a computerized
Is it legally binding that you should keep a record?
Yes. It is legally binding, sir. Consider each and every patient as a potent litigant. Yeah. Always remember, you can
because
never know which patient is going to sue you.
Why the case arised in the court of law and they said the patient to you bring all the documents. Then he said, I have the last document. Then he said, no, then your case doesn't stand. And the doctor said, I see 100 cases. I don't keep record of all. That's all. So I don't know whether it was good.
We have to keep records.
Okay, so that is you
because
have to
sometimes
keep a record.
What happens, we see the patient and the patient, it goes in another hospital, after 2 days he might become some, he might have some complication, to after 2 days he will go in some another hospital.
That's an ideal practice to keep a record, but see, in a busy OPD,
sir, because the cases have happened, sir, and the first doctor who had seen the patient was also involved, just because did not have the document. So I advise to keep an OPD documents of each and every patient.
But it's a hilarious job, because to keep all the records of 365 days and for a couple of years, it will be a lot more. So I come back again to you very specifically about the civil and criminal cases, where a doctor can be arrested and where it cannot be arrested, because Supreme Court says on a negligence, doctors should not be arrested. But still we see some reports, doctors are arrested by police. So what is that?
That's what I told you, no? After the medical board, it has given the doctor is negligent, then the investigating officer will file a charge sheet. Then the case will go on. If the doctor is proved in the court, then only he will be held criminal. Then only he will be arrested. But before arrest also, see, in the difference between a civil and criminal case is, in civil cases, the patient has to prove that the doctor committed a crime. And in criminal cases, the doctor has to prove that he's innocent. So,
don't we read in the newspaper that the patient died X place and the doctor was arrested by the police, and then there was a ruckus by the IAC in the doctor's body, then the superintendent of police intervened and then it released. So what is all this nonsense?
According to the Jacob Matthews, there is a judgment of Jacob Matthews. I advised always keep a copy of that Jacob Matthews judgment with you. And if any police officer, because these police officers, they don't know the laws. So it's you have to tell them that this is the Jacob Matthews case and you cannot arrest any doctor. Sir, sometimes in such situation, what happens? There is if there is a death in the hospital and there is a lot of ruckus in the hospital, just to avoid more violence, just for that, sometimes the police officers tell the doctors that you just come with us to the hospital so that the situation it gets a bit less tense. So in such cases, they arrest the doctor for a few hours just to cool down that situation, nothing else. Otherwise, they can't arrest the doctors.
Harsha, can you unmute Brajpal?
Sir, I have one question. I'm Dr. Sachin from Jaipur. Thank you, ma'am, and thank you, sir. Such a wonderful platform. Ma'am, I have a question that when a COVID positive patient with deranged markers like D-dimer, interleukin 6, and is also having this mucormycosis, and there is unavailability of the medicine, also amphotericin. So then how should an ENT surgeon, as a patient is having rhinocerebral mucormycosis, so should convince the patient party or should proceed with the protocol of the treatment?
You have to do the whatever. If the amphotericin is not available, antibacterial treatment, surgical treatment, whatever is there, you have to continue with it. But take the consent from the patient that amphotericin B is required in such patients, but it is not available. But still, we are trying that to at least to decrease the fungal load. We are trying to we are doing the treatment. Okay, and if you are working in a institute or a corporate hospital, then definitely you will have backup of many people. But in a single hospital, when you are it's your own hospital, then it becomes difficult to really convince the patient. But you have to convince the patient, otherwise don't take the case. What happens when a case it goes in the court, the judges, they also see the experience of the surgeon, the infrastructure of the hospital, the nursing staff, how well equipped, because there are a lot of factors which go in deciding the case against the doctor. So always take whether are you really ready to handle that such patient in your own hospital. If it's a corporate hospital, then it's okay. But will you be able to manage that patient on your own? Then only take such patients.
Okay, and ma'am, the other question is, with a raised D dimer, should we take the in consent? Should we also include the raised D dimer, like thromboembolic complications due to D dimer, raised D dimer?
Yes. In my consent form, what I have done, I have written.
Everything, yes, any sir. Possibility, should keep in mind.
Yes, sir. One way. In my consent form, what I have done, I have set a separate some few lines a blank in which I have written that the specific risks which are particular to this patient. So if there are any specific risks for that patient, you can mention it in that consent form.
Okay.
I will give my email address. I'll just, if anyone wants, just send me a mail. I'll just tell my email address, please. RUPALI Rupali YJAINJN Rupali YJN at yahoo.com. Either you send me an email, I'll send the consent form, or you can, I'm there on Facebook on Rupali Patil Jain name, and you can send me a message on Messenger. Or my phone number is 9860007387.
Okay.
You can just send me. I can send the copy.
Ma'am, can you repeat your number?
Since we are talking about
9860007387. 9860007.
Put it in the chat box. They can read. That is better.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, sir. I am not touching my phone. Otherwise, again, it will get disconnected.
Okay. No problem. Since we are talking of mucormycosis in particular, I will like to have a word of caution, because today morning somebody called me and said, in my town, no microbiologist is doing a KOH mount. Labs collect, they give the report after 2 days. And only after giving that report, the district administration will give me amphotericin B. What should I do? I said, simply, you don't keep those patients. Because if you say you sent the report for KOH mount and that takes 2 days, it is not acceptable. Am I right, Dr. Rupali?
Yes, sir.
You should have a reasonably well possibilities. As far as MRI and CT, we have discussed that lot. And today, Dr. There was a seminar going on, and beautiful from the Sion Hospital description of the how CT can differentiate different lesions. So if you don't have an MRI, you can go with the GS treatment provided you have KOH mount and amphotericin B. But if you don't have those minimum things, please don't treat it.
Yes, for all these, we need to have proper guidelines from.
Yes.
See.
Yeah. Hello. Excuse me, madam. Am I audible? This is Dr. Durga Prasad from Hyderabad. Can I speak?
Yeah, please.
Hello.
Yeah, please.
Regarding the, I have three points to make, madam. Number one, regarding the consent form that you have been telling that it could be English. Actually, in our Arogyashri scheme that is run by both the government of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, we are supposed to write in the language of the patient, at least Hindi, Urdu, and Telugu. That is a mandatory for us. So I feel that even when you are practicing, let us say near the Maharashtra or Madhya Pradesh border, as you are telling, maybe in 2-3 languages, you can feed it into the computer and get it signed in the language that the patient knows. At least if the patient is illiterate and only if it is left hand thumb impression, even then it must be read out to him or her in his or her language. That is mandatory for us. So I think if you can feed it into the computer and do it in the language of the patient, that would be much better.
I think that is the point I made at the beginning, that it can be in bilingual, trilingual, there is no harm. So long your message is clear, it's signed by the person in his or her local language. That's important.
That is important, madam. That's what I thought. The second point is that the OP records that Dr. Sagar and other people were raising, the point about maintaining the OP records. Previously, of course, you may have to maintain a file or something like that. Today, you have computers. You can simply feed it and put into Google Drive or some other mechanism whereby it is retained in it. So I don't think that is much of a problem. The second aspect is that even Medical Council of India has made it mandatory to type the prescription or to write it in capital letters. So most of the clinics now have the computer and they are typing, they are giving typed sheets, and the same thing can be stored into the Google Drive. It is important, I tell you, particularly in the government setup where I work, the patient comes innocuously, he comes for some reason, we treat him, and after a week or 15 days, he comes back with police for wound certificate. Initially, he may be coming for a normal treatment or something, but later it might turn out to be different. So it is very important that we maintain the record even in the OP, not only IP. That is our experience, madam. Actually, that is another thing.
Doctor, in a hospital setup, the HIS system, hospital information system, now is designed as such to capture all those records, you know, whatever medicine has been prescribed.
Yes, it is important that we maintain. The third point is one very disturbing aspect in the discussion. What I found was that the primary physician or the primary attending surgeon or whoever attends the case first seems to be taking the onus of the responsibility, entire responsibility. But when it's a multimodality treatment like mucormycosis, how can it hold good? See, I'm an ENT surgeon, and suppose I document, video document, the debridement that I have done cleanly, and I keep it ready. Isn't my job over? Shouldn't the onus be on the physician, nephrologist, and others?
That's probably one area the roles are not very clearly defined. That is the bigger problem.
Yes, because it's a new disease.
because subject to interpretation.
And we need to have proper guidelines also. To what exactly we do we have to follow? When we have to take an MRI? When do we, should we wait for the biopsy? There are a lot of things which we need a proper guidelines. And
the
this
biggest
is a multiple
problem, madam.
Disease, so only the ENT surgeon won't be responsible.
There are multiple guidelines. That is another problem. That is another problem. There are multiple guidelines.
No, the biggest problem, sir, is that you cannot generalize guidelines in pathology.
Yes.
Now there is so much of variation from one patient to another patient. Yeah. You cannot have a generalized guideline, even for a single disease. That is the biggest problem, and it is subject to interpretation. That's the reason why from Sessions Court to High Court to Supreme Court, the judgments keep changing about the same case. If the case will be this much the same, and the judgment keeps changing, how does it happen unless there is subject to interpretation? Now, this is the worst problem, how to solve it?
No, not only for this. Basically, any guidelines are just guideline. One has to use his or her discretion. And the discretion what you use is to be proved in the patient. Yes, can we have other speakers? Dr. Vikram raised his hand.
Dr. Vikram wants
to. Yeah, Vikram. Are you there?
Shriharsha, please unmute Dr. Vikram.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
I think I did it unmute all. Okay.
Dr. Breswal wants to ask.
Madam, if you permit me. Now, why I am telling about the subjective interpretation is that about a couple of years back, a nursing home was raided by the revenue people because there was a kidney transplantation done. It seems some money changed hands between the patient and the broker or somebody whoever has brought. Now, if the doctor is to be arrested in such a case, and if the nursing home is to be seized, why not the person who sold his kidney? See, when somebody is caught with drugs, one Dr. who Prasad, sells them, one who possesses them, both are wrong.
Dr. Prasad, it's a big, big issue. Probably the best way is we have to protect
and none of the members of IMA, nobody came to rescue the nursing home.
Yes, may I have the next speaker? Please keep your comments brief because we are running out of time. Yes, Dr. Vikram.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you for your participation, Dr. Prasad.
Dr. Rupali, wanted to ask that, nowadays we are doing a lot of online consultation for COVID patients where the primary patient is RT-PCR positive. And the close contacts, we do RT-PCR for them also. Now, if the RT-PCR comes negative, but if the blood test, the markers comes positive, do we initiate COVID treatment for them and proceed further with the CT scan, or we adopt a different strategy? For the close contact,
sir, we can proceed. If the markers are positive, we can proceed with the treatment because we all know that RT-PCR is only 70% positive.
Yes.
So we can
The general perception is that if RT-PCR is negative, people think they don't have COVID. But once they develop symptoms after 2-3 days and we do the markers, they are elevated. So can we go ahead and even do a CT scan? Yes.
We can advise a CT scan. We can advise a CT scan and ask them to continue the treatment. And if they don't agree, then
what special consent should we take while initiating treatment for these RT-PCR negative but marker positive patients, contacts?
For online consultation?
Yes.
So online consultation, you must be doing it through some apps, they come now. So they, I think they have a consent.
This is direct consultation on through references by patients who have been treated or by relatives who know. It's by direct WhatsApp call.
You are doing through WhatsApp. See, according to telemedicine, you have to keep a copy of every video call or an audio messages. So in WhatsApp, how are you going to maintain those records? you could be in a problem. So that's why there are these platforms. I think they, the video calls and all, they are recorded in those platforms.
Dr. Gopali, if you
not use much. But according to telemedicine, all those calls and the your messages, whatever you have, they have to be recorded.
Dr. Vikram, if I reply specific to your COVID, you might have seen COVID idiot. There is no point asking for a CT scan before 5 days because that it will be absolutely normal. Similarly, RT-PCR may be negative. It does not rule out that you are not suffering from COVID. So these are well established things. Yes, anybody else want to join in?
Yes, I am Dr. BP Tyagi, sir.
Oh, Tyagi, sir. Brishpal ji, namaskar.
It was a fantastic discussion between Rupali and you. We all are listening very silently. It was fantastic. I want to add one thing. In my state, this mucormycosis is declared as Mahamari, and they have nominated certain hospitals. Administration have nominated certain hospitals, like my hospital, one more hospital, to treat the mucormycosis. So it is my my responsibility to arrange the amphotericin B. It is my responsibility to arrange the ophthalmologist. It is my responsibility to treat the patient.
Okay.
I don't know about Uttar Pradesh, but in Maharashtra, there is no such, no such hospitals have been appointed. So I really don't, I can't say, comment anything on this. I don't know about the law in Uttar Pradesh.
Yes, it is in our
state. Dr. Brishpal ji, in that case, suppose any other hospital, can't they treat a case of mucor?
No, it is strictly strictly inhibited by district magistrate.
Sir, then so they must have given some guidelines regarding amphotericin. When they have appointed you, then they must have given some guidelines also.
Yeah, they all are giving amphotericin to our hospital, and my hospital is having ample supply of amphotericin B for each and every patient of mine.
So you are giving a stock of amphotericin and you have to give hisab kitab baad mein, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So that is a privilege.
Even with remdesivir, it happened.
Everybody cannot. That means you are driving the other surgeons to go for the treatment of the disease.
No, if they are willing, they can.
If I take it that way.
If they are willing to treat the mucor patient, they can approach to administration. We have to nominate it first, and then we have to treat the mucormycosis.
Okay.
In our state.
Fine enough, good enough. Yeah. Anybody else want to say anything?
Yes, please. Can I comment, please?
Coming to the documentation of the records. OPD, Medical Council of India does not talk about the preservation of the records in an OPD. It talks only about the IPD, okay, 3 years. But off late, okay, Medical Council of India rules are regulated in 2002, and afterwards there were no changes at all. But Consumer Protection Act demands the case report to be kept for 2 years from the cause of action, from the day of surgery. But 2019, a revised as amended Consumer Protection Act says that it has to be 2 years from the date of the complainant's awareness.
Yes,
okay. Dr. If he comes to know that he knows, he came to know about the complications from today, it means that from today onwards, 2 years he can file a complaint. So in all probability, what I advise you is all IP capable should be preserved for a minimum period of 5 years. And yes, sir, OPD also should be preserved, keeping in mind with a Xerox copy of it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is very, very important, because even a Consumer Protection Act says that there's a condonation of a delay or condone application if the patient files, because he was not aware of it or ignorant of the Consumer Protection Act, he will file even after 4 or 5 years
and automatically the lenience goes to the consumer, not to the doctors. So all IPD papers should be kept for a minimum period of 5 years. All OPD papers should be kept for a minimum of 3 years with the xerox copy.
Sir. See, sir, MCI has not given guidelines regarding so many things. Even for consent, if you see, there is only one line that if the woman is undergoing a sterility surgery, they have to take a consent of husband. That is the only thing. But regarding consent, it has been given in the Supreme Court judgment. So we have to, every time, you don't have to follow the MCI. We have to see what judgments have been given by the courts.
Yeah, and whatever the number of cases you see, it's immaterial. We have to have a OPD xerox copy with us, because once you give a copy to it, we don't know how he's going to change it and produce in the court of law. So to be on safer side, have a xerox copy of it with you once you give a OPD chip to the patient.
Agreed, sir. 100% correct. Anybody else? Dr. Harsha, can you just have another two comments and...
Sir, they can unmute, sir. Talk. Whoever wishes.
Most of the cases are in consumer cases. Yeah, it is the discretion of the sitting president of the consumer, okay, whether he asks for the expert opinion or not. Okay. Even if the expert opinion we get it, we may or may not rely upon that. Okay. It is the discretion of the consumer president and the members of the consumer to lay down the judgment or a decree, whatever it is, but it may accept and may not accept the expert opinion. And even same thing, even with the criminal case under 304A, many times you are booked, no doubt about it. As rightly said by Madam, Jacobi cases, they cannot arrest anybody unless that the doctor credibly, under the law, he has done a grievous mistake, a grievous thing, and where he cannot be, nothing can be done. That time only he can be arrested, otherwise he has to have an expert opinion of the same speciality, then only the law will take into action under 304A, otherwise it cannot. When if they register the FIR, it can be questioned in the High Court, and which you have done it many times in Karnataka. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Prakash, sir. Sir, there is one last question. I think during the COVID times, many of the colleagues, non-medicos, they have contacted their friends who are doctors for advice. Can a doctor refuse to give opinion on WhatsApp if it is emergency and not emergency?
Definitely. No, definitely, definitely.
And it will not hold as a negligence. The doctor.
No.
Because a lot of doctors are being called at odd times on messages.
Yes. You can definitely. You have to see the patient in person. Even according to the Telemedicine Act, you have to see the patient in person.
Yes. Ma'am, and regarding the amphotericin B, which is provided by government, is right now the deoxycholate one. And there is a liposomal which is recommended. Nowadays in the government hospital, they are telling that liposomal is given only if the patient has a chronic kidney disease. Suppose the patient dies because of a conventional amphotericin and the patient attender sues the hospital, the patient was not given liposomal even though it was available. Is it a medical negligence?
No, but you said that it was not available.
No, in the government hospital, they have an option. Because right now due to shortage of supply, there is a maximum use of deoxycholate or lipid emulsion. Now in government hospital, they have strictly been told if the patient is CKD, just give liposomal, otherwise give everyone the deoxycholate or the lipid formulation. For example, one situation, the patient has a successful surgery, but dies during the treatment procedures by medication because of the toxic effect of lipid complex or the deoxycholate. Can the patient sue the hospital that the liposomal was not given, that's why the patient died?
The patient can sue the hospital, but definitely then there will be a lot of other points which will be seen, like whether it was really available, whether it was given or not given to the... I mean, there will be a lot of points will be considered. Every time, not easily the doctor will be held negligent.
Comes into view that whether your monitoring was there or not, whether warning symptoms were there or not. So it is all circumstantial, you know. And once you have a paper, then that is going to protect you. I think that you cannot give a deoxycholate. justify your action. Am I right, Rupali?
Thank you, thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Hello?
Dr. Srihar's initial glitches, probably it was done nicely. So,
sir, thank you, sir. Actually, I was held up in the case, so I was not available. I'm really sorry.
I had a medical emergency in my house itself just 10 minutes before, and I was so much, I don't know, I could have connected, but I was so much tensed. So I'm really extremely sorry for that.
No, ma'am. There's a big queue for OT there for Mucor cases. We had to finish this case by evening. So.
Okay.
Don't worry, when I'm around, I can take care of it. Don't worry, both of you. So, okay. Good night, everybody. Thanks for joining.